Good day, good people. You're listening to Lifting the Veil. I'm your host, Carrie Lee, and today we are joined by author, researcher, and futurist Kingsley L. Dennis. Kingsley, welcome to the show.
Hi, thanks, Carrie Lee. Pleasure to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
You're very welcome. Thank you for agreeing to come on. I was introduced to you through the work of Charles Shaw. He had... We had gotten a piece from one of his earlier talks that was an excerpt from one of your books, and that is how I was introduced to you. And as I was telling you pre-show, I was very shocked that I hadn't heard about you yet, because you talk about so many of the things that are very dear to me, such as, you know, the entering into the Akashic Age and the idea that we are coming into the time of the feminine. And these are two topics that I'd really like to discuss today, but there's never a plan, so I just figured let's tell the people a little bit about yourself and how you came to be doing what it is that you're doing today.
Yeah, sure. Now, trying to make it the short answer rather than the long one, and and thanks to Charles Shaw, who's passed on my message to a lot of people that I wouldn't reach otherwise. And it's interesting that Charles actually touched upon a piece from the book, The Struggle for Your Mind, which tends to get quoted the most. Maybe the part of the reason I'm also slightly under the radar is that I'm based now in southern Spain, Andalusia. And people who make contact with me, they ask me why am I there, and they tend to think it's either because I'm joined the French Foreign Legion, I'm trying to run away from something, or I'm just a keen sun person, and it's probably none of those things really, just what happened. But to give it a short version is that I worked most of my working life in education, teaching. I worked in Central Europe, in Prague for a year. I taught in a university in Istanbul for 5 years. Then I went back to the UK, went back to university. And at the end, I co-wrote a book with a colleague at university. I was in sociology, by the way. And the book was After the Car, about looking at the future of post-peak oil societies and resources, and the kind of complex interplay of all forces. It could be environment, technology, fuel, urban living. And a lot of that work and thinking coincided with a lot of my thinking that I'd been looking at through my own seeking, let's say, my own travels and in internal processes. And I wanted to write on those things, but not within academia. And academia, I'd gone through enough years of it to realize that it's really going downhill. And it's not the free flowing environment of ideas that we were led to believe. So as is the way of my life, I come to kind of crossroads where I just get the good feeling is to make a departure and a big leap and do something totally different and to go out there. And at that time, I decided, just as my so-called career was going way up the ladder and with X amount of publications and everyone patting my back, I decided that this wasn't what I wanted to do or go, and not what I wanted to write about. So the bottom line is that I packed two bags, one bag of clothes and one bag of books, and I jumped on a plane and I landed up in Andalusia. And I thought, I'm going to sit here and write a book and then plan the next stage of my life. And that was 6 years ago and six books ago. So I'm still here.
That's brilliant. And as I'm sitting in a snow-filled day, I have to say, maybe I am just a touch envious of the sun that you're catching.
I shouldn't make it sound so good, because it is a bit of chilly here as well.
Now, you have written several books, and After the Car, New Consciousness for a New World, The Struggle for Your Mind, The New Science and Spiritual Reader, New Revolution on for a Small Planet, Beautiful Trader, an Anthology of Poems, 1992 to 2012, beautiful. Breaking the Spell, In Your Body is the Garden of Flowers, Dawn of the Akashic Age, and Meeting Monroe. Something that I've seen a lot of talks on that you have done is the idea of us coming into the time of the feminine. And a lot of people will take that and interpret it in the way that they want to. You see the feminist movement kind of making it a takeover of the feminine, which is something that it's not what it stands for. Would you agree?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's, I mean, the kind of issue is that whatever we talk about now, there's the danger that we talk about it in the old paradigm understanding. So really what I'm trying to grasp and what I try to tackle with in my thinking and my work is the whole type of transition, the bigger picture, and trying to look at all the dots changing. And so this, you know, what I from my perspective is that we can't really look at trying to move towards the future unless we can change our consciousness first. So all this talk about how do we deal with environment and how do we deal with technologies and authoritarian structures, for me, they're like spokes on a wheel, and they all come back to the hub, which is human perception and human consciousness. And if we can't change our inner state and the way we perceive the world, then it's very difficult, almost impossible, really, to create long-term viable harmonious solutions, because really the world is a kind of reflection of our own state and where we are. So if we talk about feminine consciousness and feminine energy, and I call it that really because I'm using vocabulary which people can come together with. I'm not talking about feminism or genders. I'm not talking about genders either. I'm talking about a different energy coming in. And this is also an energy of consciousness, an energy perception, an energy of being. So the problems that we have around us, a lot of it has come through the last few thousand years, well, probably all of it really, the last few thousand years of a consciousness which has been very linear, very hierarchical. And this is why a lot of the religious systems have been based on hierarchical structures, a lot of the authorities we see in politics. And yet what we're seeing now is a different connectivity, a different communication, a different relational being between people. And we can talk about that more. But for example, I feel that the internet embodies that, in that it's going from the internet embodies a kind of distributed, bottom-up, decentralized way of connecting, which many people have talked about in different ways, and a way of multitasking, a way of being relational, and also dealing with empathy and feedback and dealing with all that. And that for me is a way of working, way of being, which has very much been a part of the consciousness and the energy of what we know as being feminine, in that it deals with relational elements. It deals with, again, for want of a better word, multitasking. It deals with connectivity and communication and thinking in multiple ways, not just in linear ways. So when I talk about the moving ahead and moving into, would I say, the Akashic or moving ahead in consciousness and social systems, it's all based around consciousness, which is, I see, shifting into an area which, for in terms of our understanding, has been more associated with the feminine consciousness or energy. Does that make sense?
No, it does, because in a feminine energy, it's a creative force. And it's a nurturing force. And this is something that we see coming about in these times. I think that it's hard to get the language to catch up to what the consciousness is at this time, though. And the only way that we can explain it is, I mean, even my understanding, the way that you're saying all of this is quite brilliant. And I don't necessarily have that articulation, but I can relate to it and it speaks to me. I understand, as I do my own studies, that in the masculine sense, and I don't like the gender boxes, it's very uncomfortable, but in the masculine sense, there is that linear thought pattern, whereas in the feminine, there are several, like you said, multitasking, That's the way that the feminine works. So we're coming into that, but as I said, the language just, we're not there yet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we shouldn't really be talking in terms of gender, because that's a divisive, a kind of polarity language and way of seeing the world, which has been one of the factors in social management from the hierarchies for so long, is this divisive polarity. So, and thinking just in terms of one gender against the other is part of that trap, and which is that what we have to break through and understand it in a kind of integral way. So, although I'm a man and I may be criticized for talking about this feminine consciousness, again, it's not about being a man or woman talking about these things. It's just trying to embrace a different way and perceiving of doing things. And to use words, it seems to be an energy which has been more, let's say, inherent or natural or organic to a way that women understand this energy. And that's why we're talking about it in that way at the moment.
The way that I find it, I see a lot of women are taking it on as, okay, it's women's time to rule again, kind of type thing. And that's just not what it is, because it's a matter of balance on the inside. I see it happening with men, and I think it's beautiful, where they're balancing themselves out and they're able to take the feminine and masculine and blend it together so that there's more balance. I also see females doing the same thing. It's happening. And, there's always those stragglers or whatever you might want to call them. I don't want to put anybody into any boxes, but there's always those ones that take it to the extreme, the fundamentalists. You find it in religions, you find it in any kind of thesis, any kind of, there's always going to be those extremists.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And extremists, again, belong to that, the old paradigm, the old model that's been with us for so long. And extremism and fundamentalism in any area is not beneficial. We know of extremism in terms of religion mostly, but for example, the greed to do good is still a greed. So it's all about really finding a balance internally that makes us more, in a way, more we can connect with what's going on around us in a more balanced way, because the world is changing in the way that systems are changing, energy is changing. And what I sense is that more and more the younger people and more those who will be born into the world will start to operate more from a kind of instinct and a kind of internal knowing. So they won't probably be worried too much about trying to label it or trying to talk about it. They'll just sense it and know it. And that type of knowing will bypass all our problems of the Tower of Babel that we're living in now.
That's such a... I see it in my children. I can see how that it works in the children that are being born. I can see how those of us in our generation are struggling with it, because we've been so dominated by the language that we struggle to not have to feel like we're stepping on any toes trying to explain things. So it's a little bit more complicated, I think, even though we might innately feel it. It's the expression. I had said in a post that we all speak different languages to the same ends. And we're getting caught up in the language, and we find ourselves fighting over these language barriers. And really, when you break it all down, we really are saying the same things, but we're just taking a different path to get there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That reminds me of an old, I suppose I called a wise man's joke, which I heard when I was in Turkey. And it's about a wise fool had been brought to the king of the country because he was found out to be criticizing the king and talking his own wisdom. And so he was brought to the king, and the king said, "How dare you talk about your own wisdom? I have a room full of philosophers here, and we are the state wisdom." And so the fool said, "Well, okay, then bring them here. Now I'll just have a little, let me spend a few minutes with them." So the 10 wise men came into the room, and the fool said to them, "I want each of you to write down on a piece of paper, what is bread?" And so all the philosophers like looked at each other strangely, and so they, "Well, what is bread?" So they all wrote their conclusions down. And when the fool read the answers out to the king, we had 10 different answers. There was, "Bread is a mixture of flour and wheat," or, "Bread is a staple diet of our country." And every answer was differently. And the fool turned around to the king and said, "Is this your the best you can do for your wise men? They can't even agree on what is the most basic thing we have in our country." So that's a like analogy that an analogy that we have here, Carolee, is that we have all these vocabulary and all these terms, but really we're all trying to grasp at talking about the fundamental thing which we all have inside of us. It's, maybe we can call it a heart language or this intuition and or gnosis, but we have to let go a little bit and stop trying to categorize things and try to, I suppose, live through instinct and the flow, and that's what is going to be coming about more, I feel, or being more successful in coming about.
Yeah, I have to agree because you see the synchronicities. I think I notice since, I want to say very, very strongly since 2009, 2008, I've seen that synchronicities have been something that are so powerful. And they're shared by people on the opposite side of the world from where you sit. And it's like amazing to know that there is that connection, that there is that synchronicity between all of us. Together, no matter how far apart we are, we do feel these similar feelings. And as you said, it's a there's just language barrier, it seems. Now you've talked about religion, and I'm curious as to what do you think is going to be that, I don't know, that final moment where we realize that we don't need it anymore, or where that it's not needed and it's not serving us. I think I see it breaking down. I think we all see it breaking down, but it's not quite, it's at its height of, I don't know, disaster, it would almost seem, and everybody seems to be gripping at the sides of the box where the flaps are opened at the bottom, and clinging so tightly, but it's gone. Like it truly is gone. It's not serving us anymore, if it ever did. The patriarch is never, as far as I'm concerned. But I mean, what do you see coming about in this?
Yeah, that's a good point. I like your metaphor on the box as well. Well, religion, I mean, perhaps one of the signs that people are apprehensive is that this kind of hanging on. For example, a drowning person often will be more grasping, and they always say, "Be careful when you go to rescue a drowning person; they may pull you down with them because they're in a flap." So religion has been a kind of crutch or a scaffold for many people. And also as a social scaffold. But what they've tried to do, and that is how they've consolidated their power, is because they've set themselves up as the brokers, the kind of middle person between yourself and the divine source. So it's almost as if by saying, "Well, come on, folks, you wouldn't know how to reach the divine source anyway, so we'll be the broker for you." And that was evident for so long through the, let's say, the priestly case, or even from the Egyptian days era. And also it's so telling because the Bible had in Latin, and only the priests were able to read it, and the masses were more or less, before the printing press came along, were illiterate and kept that way. And you have the for example, the Cathars, their kind of annihilation was again a sign that any group who stood up and tried to promote the gnosis, that a person's direct connection to the inner source, were really wiped out, to put it in put it in blunt terms.
I agree with you 100% because it's been like I feel strongly like a drive in me to get people to understand that we were all of this oral tradition, that we passed everything down orally for so very long and then it was wiped from us. But if you look at it, all the tribal peoples, they've all been wiped out, and all of their ceremony and all of their ritual and all of their individual connection has been destroyed, so that these brokers, as you say, and the taxing of it is our souls. You know, that's the payment of all of this for them to broker between ourselves and the divine. But it was very, very clever for them to turn around and steal all the secrets and then make it so that, you know, wipe out the tribes, genocide throughout the entire world. If you think any, I don't know anybody who can't see it. But something that has been very strong in me, and you see it with the indigenous peoples around the world now that are standing up for environmental reasons, because of the fracking, because of the tar sands, because of the rainforest pillaging and whatnot. And this is going to sound maybe a touch racist, and I hope nobody takes it that way, but I'm going to say whatever I say because that's what I do. The white people have forgotten that once long, 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 long ago, we were tribal and we had all of these things, and it was wiped out of us first almost. And then when you look at the indigenous now that are left, it's like the last frontier for destroying that individual connection to source that we most definitely have, but they're crying out to show us that it still exists.
What you say is right, and it was a very deliberate extermination of the source of the transmission of knowledge through the indigenous elders and the shamanic wisdom traditions. When invading armies went into other lands, the first thing they did was to burn down the libraries and again try to destroy any opposing knowledge. And that's really the world that we've inherited, and that even now this so-called globalization, which is a kind of n neo-imperialism, is just trying to place over one knowledge structure over another. But that has no future, because how can that compete against a multitude of people who are reconnecting with that inner source, and will increasingly be so through the generations coming in? And I feel that, and I sense that with my own gnosis, is that there's a kind of change in the energy now that is allowing or making it easier for people to reconnect with their inner knowing and inner source. So whereas previously we had these initiation ceremonies where people had to go through long training to connect with an inner source or inner wisdom, that's kind of that's coming out now, and there's a kind of massification of inner gnosis, to use those words. Just to give a kind of almost a kind of trivial example, I remember in my early years, I was reading books such as The Mystery of the Cathedrals by Fulke Nelly, which was it was a kind of an ancient alchemical text, and in his day it was never even disseminated. It was disseminated after his death, and it was still a hard book to get hold of. And then recently I was in a low budget shopping center, and I saw on a bookstand near the counter books for children, and one of them was a translation of this book. It was in Spanish because of his local area. And so within these years, you've gone from a sacred text being not being disseminated, being disseminated to a small group, and now translated as a children's book. I mean, that's really just an analogy to say that this information now is coming out, and it's kind of mirroring an ex for me, this is only my interpretation, is that it's mirroring and also coming out internally. So external knowledge and information is being more widely available. At the same time, we are feeling a connection to it, and it's like a convergence externally, internally. We're converging to get a grasp of this new sense of information and knowledge. That's my take.
Yeah, no, it's we don't it's trusting that inner knowledge now, though, that it's for us to, I think that's the one of the key points, is that we're just getting to that point, I know my, well, maybe I'm speaking for myself, that I can finally trust that inner voice, and that I don't have to look outside of it for any kind of, justification for the way that I'm coming about these things. It's gotten to that point where I just know, and you follow that bliss and you work it out. And very, very seldom is that inner knowledge wrong.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just like trusting your gut instinct, your gut feeling, that little tickling in your belly. And we've all had that, and we all talk about trusting your gut instinct, but or trusting your body language, the innate body. For example, if you're in a situation and something doesn't feel right, you get the vibes, you get the tingle of your body knows. And your body is also part of that whole gnosis of the inner knowing, the heart knowing, the gut instinct. And the reason why we've been not led to trust that is because of our social conditioning into an external dependency. And it's what we may call the fear of freedom, because we're afraid to let go, because we think there's nothing out there to hold on to. And that's been strengthened by a lot of our dependency on financial systems and credit systems and work, and a lot of things which, understandably, for many people, it's hard to step back from that and to create some independence. But when you start to trust yourself, you'll see what I felt from my own experience. The connections in life change. You start making other connections, different synchronicities, and things start to flow, and the world's almost trying to beg us to follow what's right for us, because that is that flow which is duly needed.
Yeah, I agree, and just allowing ourselves to just be, and not fighting against it. It's really incredible when you begin to do that, though. And then, yeah, I'm going to say, I always fall back into old habits, but I'm really grateful that the generations coming aren't going to have that struggle quite as much.
Yeah, and a lot of it is down to the families we've been, our peer pressure in the family. So if we had parents that, in their mindset, they want the best for us, and the best for us in their day was a very secure job and getting up along the ladder and etc. And so there's fear on their part for allowing their children to kind of go off and find their own path, and they worry about us. And so it's been difficult for them, and it's difficult for example, our generation to kind of break away from parental wishes and desires and say, look, just trust me on this for a while. And so if we can make that first step, and like you say, you've with your children, Carolee, you mentioned that you've allowing them to be and homeschooling. Once the first generation lets go and it's easier for the next generation, then once that break's been made, the floodgates can open. And the change is much faster.
No, it's definitely true. And you can see that once people show other people that it's okay, you need those I don't know, way showers, you might want to call them, although again, no boxes. But once you have those way showers that are there, those people that are living it, it's an example. And then others aren't quite so afraid. And I know, if I were to rewind back into my life, because there was that time where I was listening to societal and parental worries and what was expected of me. And the minute that I stopped doing that was when my life evolved. And now I can say that because I have let go of what other people think or what other people expect from me, I find myself living my childhood bliss. What I do here is something that makes me incredibly happy. It's something that gives me great joy in knowing that not only am I learning as I go, but I'm sharing with whoever's willing to listen, not force feeding it to anybody, but knowing that anybody that wants to listen can. I'm dabbling in all the little creative things that meant so much to me that I never allowed myself to do for fear of, oh, all kinds of things. Oh, I'm not going to make it. I need something to fall back on. It's not logical to want to do this, that, and the other. There's nothing to be made in art and music. And, you know, I don't listen to that now. And here I am at 38 years old, living as if I have just graduated from school and am able to do exactly what I want. I don't think it's a midlife crisis. I think it's like a midlife awakening.
Yeah, sounds like a midlife new life.
It really does. And that's how it feels, because it's for the first time you're true to who you are. And I see so many other people that are experiencing that by just allowing themselves to do what truly makes them happy without any conditioning that goes along with it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And each one of us has to make that decision and make that choice and make the leap for ourselves, because no one else can do it for you. So I've had old friends of mine and old school buddies, and they look at me and say, oh, you're doing, you know, all you've always wanted, you're happy, and I, you know, it's good for you. And I said, yeah, but you know, I had to make a lot of choice along the way, and choices to be here and give things up. And my dear parents have allowed me to do that. I remember my dad took me to the train station when I came here to Spain for the first time. So they thought I was going to be a professor and, you know, be work at the university and be a good chappy and academic. And there I was with my two bags. And he looked at me, and my parents have never really questioned me too much. They've always let me kind of find my way. My dad looked at me, and for the first time he said, son, do you really know what you're doing? And I said something to the effect of, all I know is that I have to make this move to make things happen for me. And he just went, okay, fair enough, and gave me a hug. And now he's happy. He's, I validated that move by what I've done now. And it's just fear. I think fear really is the greatest barrier to human consciousness, because one tiny bit of fear is like a dark room, and you think the dark room, there's never going to be a way to bring light to that. What we all have to realize is that it doesn't take a room of light to get rid of that fear. It just takes a little match. Strike a little match and you can take that darkness away. So we are miraculous. Human beings are miraculous. And if we just go with that, then we can dispel any fear, because you know we're 1,000 matches. We have to just get used to lighting them.
No, exactly. And then the torch and the beacons arrive. Mm-hmm. We create them.
Yeah. So it is that time of transition now, and I've the way I kind of refer to it. I mean, I've just been writing some work now, and I refer to the children coming as the Phoenix generation, as though they will be a part of the change makers to rise new systems from the ashes, to use a metaphor. And I refer to us now, people in our generation, as the bridge generation, because they've got one foot in the old paradigm and the old vocabulary and the old energy, which is very disturbing and can be quite disruptive.
Uncomfortable.
Yeah, it's uncomfortable, and sometimes we don't know what to do with it. But at the same time, we know we've got one foot in the other side of the bridge, and we're reaching out to what's coming in. And we've got to straddle those two energies, and we've got to be the bridge. And it's uncomfortable to be the bridge, but that's where we're at right now. This transition is about not letting everything crash at once, because that'll just be anarchy. But letting things come in to replace the old systems, the old energy. We don't want a time of anarchy. We want a time of replacement. And so we have to hold hands of both sides, the old and the new, until we can bring something in that replaces it. That's the way I see it, Carly.
Now, what do you see as a replacement for what we're in right now? I often try to sit back and imagine what it would be like once, you know, the old political systems are no longer, because obviously they're not useful. You see what's happening in the world. There's no place for the political system as it is. I don't want to see a world that, say, the Venus Project is imposing. I don't want to live in a retractable home. I want to tend my gardens. I don't want machines doing my work and making my bread, these types of things. What is your, just your vision on what you see happening to be the replacement for these constructs?
Well, you see, I'm not sure if I can actually say what will be the replacement. I can probably say more about how I think they're going to come in.
True enough.
Because I don't feel I have the answers. I think the answers are going to be from the younger generation. They're the ones who are going to have better ideas than I have. I try to look at what I see, like the trends. What I do feel is that for anything to have a real working long-term viability, is that it has to really connect with the human spirit, in that sense of a sense of being, the sense of understanding. Because otherwise, if the state of our human understanding is not at a level of the technologies coming in, then the danger is that those technologies will just not work for us and just become a technologized societies, as you kind of made mention to. So we need that inner knowing, which I feel the younger generations do have, which is I think a saving grace. And we have to understand that the old guard has to die away for the new to come in. So the people who are in political systems now, the people who are in the financial systems, they're going to be replaced, because that's a natural process. They'll be replaced by younger people coming in who are going to be thinking differently. So what I don't feel is going to happen is a great big global collapse. I mean, we've had a semi kind of collapse with the financial system in 2008. But if all these systems just have a huge collapse, then we will have an anarchy, because, you know, society is too ingrained to have a complete, takeaway or collapse. So what I feel is happening is that it's more going to be, rather than a kind of revolution or a replacement of the center, it's going to be pockets of change coming in from the periphery, like pockets of change in the network. And these are going to be groups, and it's happening now already, groups all around the world doing their thing. So rather than waiting for an almighty revolution, they're just going ahead and doing it.
That's exactly what's happening now, is that you see all these individuals that are going out and living it, and stepping away from the protests, and stepping away from the revolution, and stepping away from the aggression, and just becoming that change and living it, and, you know, doing their homesteading and homeschooling, what they're eating, what they're growing, what they're feeding their minds, what they're feeding their children on so many different levels. So it is by far already happening.
I always go back to that. I think it's a wonderful spot on quote by old Buckminster Fuller, old bookie boy. And he said, and I'm paraphrased that, he said, to create a new system, you don't change a system by going on full head on. You create a new model that makes the old model obsolete. And I think that's a wonderful way of looking at it. So instead of like banging our heads against a wall, we have to just walk around the wall and create something different. And the danger is that we should not play ball with the ruling structures, because they want us to be aggressive, because then it gives them reason to be more aggressive and authoritative back to us. What they won't see coming is the small changes happening around the world by people doing their own thing, because that's exponential change. You know, if changing the center from the status quo is linear change, it just, you know, it's the same thing we've had for years and years and years. You know, it's just one thing happening onto the next. It's called trend forecasting is a case in point. Everyone thinks the future is going to be just as the same, but a little bit different from before. Well, I don't think that's going to happen. I think the change is going to be exponential, because it's coming from all over the world, people in all different walks of life and all different backgrounds come together, and it's called networking social communication, and it's going to rise up from the periphery and is going to come in and just really it's going to be a silent takeover, or as I like to call it, a kind of underwhelming of the present system.
But you know, it's very true though, because we sit back and we look at what we have now, and we have this wonderful tool called the internet that has made us so readily available for each other from one end of the world into the other. And you see that we have this ability now to really get together and talk about things that we were never able to before, and learn things that we were not able to before, and connect in a way that we were never able to before. And now, as you see these little silent cells of people that are making all of these changes, it's just rendering everything else obsolete. And then all of a sudden, media, for example, I was saying that we all need to be, Thomas Sheridan also had said, you know, we all need to be doing this in some way, shape, or form, creating our own media, creating our own art, creating our own. And it is a trend, and it is something that is happening, and more people are picking up, say, a microphone or a camera or a pen or typing at their computer or a paintbrush and making it all happen. And it's going to render the mainstream media absolutely obsolete. It's already happening.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. And that's probably one of the reasons why the mainstream media doesn't like to highlight it or talk about it, because they know it's going on, and it's almost inevitable. Is that because you see, previously in the past, people were just to use that, I don't like to use the word, but they were masses. They were just masses, and when they're a mass, they're just like a group, and so groups can be more easily collectively manipulated and controlled. What we are now is a kind of individualized mass, and we're connecting outside of our borders, outside of our boxes, and even outside of our comfort zones. And so when that's happening, it's really sparking the creative individual. And the creative individual has always been the catalyst for change and growth. In the past, they were referred to as maybe conscious change agents, and you know, or maybe they were people who were seen as way showers, or sometimes mystics, or sometimes even crazies, or people who would, or eccentrics. They're always people who were going out there and trying to look at, you know, point out that the paradigm is all topsy-turvy and there's a new way of doing things. Well, now all those creative individuals are coming together and connecting with like-minded souls and like-minded hearts, and that's an energy which is really exponential, and try stopping that.
Exactly. There is no stopping it. And that's the thing, where we've all really gotten to the point that we're conduits to each other, and we understand that we are feeding each other. We are feeding each other energy. We are taking that energy and we are feeding others with it, which is very beautiful to see that free flow of idea and beauty and creation that's coming forth. And which brings me back to, you know, the idea of the rise of the feminine. There are more of us creating now than, I don't know, I can't give you a time frame of when the last time in our society that this was happening. We are at a time right now where the artists are really making a mark in this world and making the changes, which is absolutely beautiful. And it's nurturing and it's feeding our souls. And it's something that has been so needed because we've been shut off to it for so very long.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like we've been starved. It's almost as if the human heart and human soul has been starved. In a sense, it has, because it's been shut away, waiting for it to be listened to for all this time, and so few of us have been listening to it. And the reason why also that so many people could be creative nowadays so much more is that we don't need that much to go out there and do it. You know, we don't need some big corporation to fund us anymore. You know, we can reach out to our friends. I mean, crowdsourcing is an example of that. That if little bits from the people around us, we can help. And also, we don't need some big corporative distribution company to distribute our products. We can do it again through the network. So we are the people are cutting out the middle person, and you know, and that's why they're going a little bit crazy and disruptive and trying to make propaganda and fear, is because they know we're doing it and they can't really stop it.
No, there is no stopping it. And that's the beautiful thing about an energy once it begins, isn't it? That it just, there is no stopping it. It just creatively flows and it just keeps on going. And there's no barrier for it. I mean, I'm sure there could be some type, but I doubt very much that there's a stopping of this wave that we're going through.
When I talk, you know, we're talking a lot about this energetic, this positive energy, and this is where I'm focused and I'm concentrating on now. And I just thought, like to say that, you know, for years and years, as I was growing up, I was following all the what has been called conspiracy news or information or alternative theories, and I was following that, and I would always read that news and read about, I covered it in my early work. Where I knew more or less they were saying about the conspiracies, but I just didn't want to listen to it anymore. I kind of realized that the more we listen to it, the more it's just distracting us. And that itself is a mechanism to distract us from ourselves. So the more we follow all the elements that are against us, we're missing all the elements that are on our side. So now I don't really pay much attention to all these, too much of the conspiracy news and that. I just get on and do my thing and connect with people who are doing their thing. And I think that's a greater way. That's what I'm feeling.
I agree with you. Now, something that I need to bring up that has always been a bit of a thorn in my side is the idea that people are afraid of the shadow, though. And they would run, and I don't think that this is what you're saying by any means, but I think it's something that needs to be addressed, is that we can't just look at the light, because the light will blind you. You have to, there has to be a balance. Now, okay, so I say there has to be a balance, and everybody can just, you know, slap me upside the head if you think I'm wrong. I don't mean it that way, but you know. Now, let's really talk about that. Is there an illness in seeing the light only?
That's what I've been also trying to get to grips with, is that there needs to be a kind of intelligent balance, because otherwise we're not prepared. So on the one hand, if it's all these all the kind of negative news or the very hardcore news about what's the ruling authorities are doing, then our type of preparation may be just do external, i.e. we barricade ourselves, but we don't feed some kind of internal sense of where direction we should go in. So we need to know, you know, what's happening. So preparing ourselves and preparing other people, and what's the best balance? Perhaps it's a balance of showing what's out there, but rather than saying, you know, we're doomed or we need a revolution, we're saying, well, that's what's out there. Now let's look at what we can do, but in our own way, rather than just playing into their system. So it's a balance of being aware, but not distracted by their disruption. That's what I feel.
I agree. You can't ignore the truth of what's going on, but you can't dwell in it, because it'll take you over. And then, you know, you kind of become that which you are against, sort of, because you end up being, you're perpetuating it, and you can't perpetuate it. You have to find some kind of balance and live in your own truth. So I really appreciate the way where you took that. We're coming to a point where balance is so very important, and that's what it comes to, bringing ourselves into that balance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm often reminded of the phrase of the old wise fool himself, Timothy Leary, and he said that everybody needs their own inbuilt bullshit detector. So we need to have that detection. But we need, what I feel is that everything is about being in an integral harmony. That's with ourselves and the world, That between the genders and the male and female and the different energies. It's about the con, and that's also the bigger picture we can say between science and spirituality. Things we don't need opposites to distract us in the either or camp. We want to find a balance that's integrative. And that I feel is the crux of that is the integration between our inner state and our inner world and the outer world that we're a part of. Internal and external is one thing, it's the same, it's unified, there's no difference.
No, as above, so below, it's all tied in. Definitely. And it's not something that we're used to. It's language that we're not used. Well, our generation isn't used to speaking that language. We're used to an either or. We're used to a right and left. We're used to red pill, blue pill. We're used to white and black. We're used to that yin and yang without integration. I think we miss the whole point that it's stuck, that yin and yang is within a circle.
That's part of the shift, and that's part of the energies. It's it's for example, if you throw a pebble in a pond, you get the ripples going out. You throw two pebbles in, you get the interference ripples when they collide. And I think that's what's happening now is that we've got the ripples of the old energy, the old consciousness, at the moment colliding with the ripples of the new consciousness, and that's making disruption. But there's a kind of changeover happening. We've got to ground ourselves. We've got to, make sure we don't go crazy in this time because there's enough things to make us go crazy, and we need to reach out and connect with those people who are, of like-minded energy and that are going to support us. We don't want to spend our time or waste our time with people who are just not, not on the same page, or I don't want to waste my time debating with other people because I don't want to debate,
You know, that's
you
funny that you say that because I feel the same way lately. I felt compelled to debate, and yet I see that there's just no need for it. It's an energy vampire. And people say, well, good debate makes for, knowledge and learning and all of these things. And to an extent, I agree with that. But you can find that you can have conversations with like-minded individuals and have, oh, I don't want to say a debate because that's not what it is. You just circle around all of these influential conversations and all of these different beautiful bits of knowledge that we get. And instead of fighting over what is right and what is wrong, you're able to just disseminate it all together instead of arguing about it because there's no point in that. And it's gotten to the point where I would rather, oh, Facebook, the beautiful social network that it is, I would rather block somebody that's being incredibly adversarial at this point or just ignore it than even touch upon it because it's not worth it to me. It's not worth, oh, this is so sad. It's not worth my, I mean, I sad, I don't mean it, and I hope everybody understands what I mean. I don't want to waste my precious energy that can be put towards something more unifying, that can be put towards something more productive, that can be put towards something that's going to benefit myself and the people that I surround myself with. And that's not to say that I think that everybody else doesn't count. But if you're not on the same page, why are we fighting? Why are we? It's obvious that, you're on page 19 and I'm on page 18, and I'm not where you are, or you're not where I am, and I can't pull you along with me, and you can't pull me along with you. So why can't we just let it be?
Yeah, I totally agree with you. We do not need to waste our energies. If someone else has an opposing opinion, I respect that and say that's your opinion and mine's different, and fair enough. Because I've if you listen, if you watch, it's even interesting if you watch people having an argument or debate. I've noticed that they're not really listening; they're just waiting for the other person to stop so they can put their point forward. And all the time, they just really you can see the clogs in their mind working. They just want think of a counter argument, and this may have been used from the days of rhetoric in the past when it was a so-called skill they taught it in the old universities. But these days we don't have time for that, and we don't. And as you rightly say, if someone is not going to come along with us, then fair enough. It's not a let's say a rejection. It's just a recognition. Like, okay, you're working things out in your way. I'm not here to convince people. I'm not a missionary, you know. I'm just here to talk and to talk constructively. I don't want to change your mind if your mind is not for changing.
No, definitely not. And I think my greatest lesson at this point is not feeling the need to defend. Because that's a big thing for a lot of us, is that we want so badly for people to just accept us as we are. And it's not about that. And this is something that Charles had said to me, is just believe in you. Let the rest of it go and believe in you. And it's got to be some of the best and advice I've ever been given. And at the same time, it's something I always knew.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. As we don't take anything personally. I think that was one of the old Toltec teachings. Don't take anything personally, because when someone is criticizing you, really, it's often they've got an issue with themselves. And we all do that. We all project. So, that again goes back to the old fear of what, you know, keeping up with the Joneses and what the neighbors would say, and, you know, try to not stick out from the crowd. But those days are gone. The energy supports a different way. The energy supports a way of being, which is being true to the self. And more people are following that. And that's what's going to be a part of the flow.
I agree. So now you're in Spain.
Mm-hmm.
And you're enjoying your fireside your fireside conversation. I'm enjoying the fireside conversation. I wish I had a fire.
Yeah. Can you feel the heat?
I've lit a candle in solidarity. But what do you find yourself doing these days? What keeps you creative, and what has your attention, and what's inspiring you in this time right now?
I'm inspired to be here, and I'm looking forward to every day in the future. I've been told that I have writer's diarrhea because I just don't stop writing.
You know how many writers with writer's block sit there and go, "Oh, come on." But it's beautiful, because it's what you're meant to do, and if you're doing it free flowing like that, my goodness, good for you.
Yeah. For me, let's say I'm trying to follow what I feel is right, and really I'm trying to develop myself and work on myself and be a better person and understand the world better, and to be creative as well. My first love before I started writing the serious books was poetry. I've been writing poetry since I was 15, so I've been republishing some of that poetry. Now we can do with self-publishing, and I'm just preparing a collection that I wrote actually 10 years ago called Songs of a Man Who Died of Love, about really all the poems were about the inner longing for connection and love, but love in the grander sense, not in the corporal sense, although it can include that. And I'm also now doing some audio readings of putting that out. So, and also I'm writing more personal stuff that just I self-publish, because I'm not interested if a traditional publisher doesn't want it. I want to just put it out there. And now I'm also going back to writing my first children's book. So I started writing books, fiction, before I wrote these non-fiction books. So I'm trying to be creative. And what I have in mind, what I keep in my heart is, I remember a phrase from the Persian poet Rumi, and I paraphrase him, but he said something like, if you do everything in the world, everything for fame and prestige, but if you forget to do that one thing, then you will have done nothing. But if you can do that one thing, whatever else in the world, whatever else you do, it doesn't matter, you will have done everything. And so, Carolee, I'm trying to find out what is that one thing.
I can relate to that. I like the idea that you said that you're just writing to write, and you're putting out personal things, and it's not for anybody. Am I right to say, okay, is it right to say that there's that idea that you're writing this because you're purging, and at the same time, you know that there's those people that need to hear these words.
Yes, it's a bit of both. I probably wouldn't say purging, but maybe I'm working through my understanding of myself and how I see the world. And that's a process of writing. My own understanding comes through the writing. It's really a conversation with the self. And what I wish to do is try to elucidate that and join the dots and make it in a way which perhaps will be useful for other people. And so it will be of benefit. And so that's the work that I put out with the books and the publishers. And then there's personal work with I'm just happy to really be creative and do that and to self-publish it, because it's not for money, it's not for status, it's just something which is part of my own process. So I think I sense that if my understanding is that if we do things for a pure intention, the intention to be of benefit, the intention to give something to others and to the world and to ourselves, then the end will be found. The work will stand up and do its thing. But if we have the intention just to make money, or just to have want to be some status, then something is going to come along and it's going to be 15 minutes of fame, or you're going to have an up and a down. It's all about intention, and a lot of, and everyone out there that I want to connect with, the people that I would like to think are reading my work, are people that are going to spot the energy of the intention. And so I've got to try to be honest with them.
Yeah, and when you're putting something out with that type of intention of purity, of love, because that's what it is. When you're putting something out, it's a labor of love. It gives back. And it continues to give back. It's constantly replenishing.
Yeah, and I have to also recognize that the choice that I made is part of being here living in southern Spain, because I wouldn't be able to do what I'm doing living in my native country in England, because I can't afford to live in England. I couldn't afford to live, but basically that's it. I can't afford to live there and do what I do. I'd have to have a supplementary income or another job. Living here, I live in a rural area. I live off the water mains. I have an 18-meter water well. I grow my own vegetable. I have my own fruit trees. And it's a poorer agricultural area of Spain. And I can live here very, very comfortably, and have what I feel I'm having a rich life, and I'm very grateful. And so it goes with what I'm doing. And so when we make a choice to do things, we have to perhaps think about the environment which will support the choices we make.
That's so very true. So very true. And it's nice to hear you say that you understand. And it's not about power. It's not about fame. It's not about money. It's about living your bliss.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we have to be practical at the same time. If you can't live your bliss in the social environment that you are, then you have, one would have to think, well, what can I do to make it possible? Because it is possible. It's just we have to tweak, maybe change our priorities. And so we have to be practical at the same time. That money is an energy that allows us to live, and it's how we use it. And it can be used to make the bliss as well, as long as it's not the primary intention. That's how I feel.
No, definitely not. And I think it's important that people understand that we're citizens, that we're part of this world as a whole. We're not tied to one country or the other. Mm-hmm. We can go just about anywhere we want to do what we want, and it's up to us to make sure that we work towards manifesting that. A lot of people have looked at myself, my family, and, how do you do that? And you had even said you give up things. And I'm not quite sure if it's actually giving things up, but letting them go because they're just not necessary anymore. Mm-hmm. We've given up or let go of several different things and then realized that they weren't serving us in the first place, that they were more of a blockade to where we actually wanted to strive towards. Just like when you change maybe your way of thinking that you may lose some friends, but are you really losing friends? Or are you just, you know, walking away from a stagnant energy to a more lively one? I'm not sure. I don't have all the answers by any means, but I don't believe that we're giving anything up.
Mm-hmm. No, and it's not a bad thing to downsize, but downsizing is really just the way of not accumulating anymore. You know, so imagine this transition we're in. It's like the boat is sinking and we've got to get to the next shore. This is a transition. So, you know, you'd think it would make sense to throw things off the boat that we don't need rather than accumulating more. So part of it's common sense. We don't need more. We've been told we need more. We just need to declutter ourselves, just as, for example, right now in December, I'm in the garden pruning back the trees, because when you prune them back, they grow stronger in the next season. And we just need to prune back a bit and cut off the useless branches of our own lives, and so we can grow towards that bliss.
You know, it's funny that you say that, because everything happens for a reason. And as I've told my listeners before, no show comes to me at a time that is not most important in my life for some reason. And okay, you can say that I'm self-centered, but I then put it out there and then I have the listeners sit back and say, wow, I feel the same way. So it's a trend. It's another way of the energy is a trend. And in this last 2 years, we got rid of so much, and the universe decided that it wasn't enough, and you know, and said, well, you know, I know that you have this whole storage unit that's way over here and you want all of your stuff back, but you don't need it all. And it was hard. It was really hard. There was an attachment to it. And you go through a kind of mourning, but the idea is that you have to, I mean, I have to sit back and be grateful now, because yes, I don't have that attachment to it now. I understand that I didn't need it, that we didn't need it, and we needed to let go, and that's okay. And it really is the universe's way of saying, okay, I know you thought you were doing good, but you can do better.
You thought the universe wasn't looking.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's you can't cheat these things. We only cheat ourselves with a bit of, you know, old human delusion, which we are quite apt at doing. But we can't really fool the universe. So you know, the universe, you know, gives out a lot of nudges. We can call them synchronicities, what Jung called them. We can call them coincidences or you know. I mean, what are coincidences? They're just, you know, we're being poked to really look at the signals and to make the change. And more people are listening to that. And when we talk like we're talking now, you know, we can feel the energy, because we know, I mean, I feel that when I'm saying something, you understand it. And I hope maybe you feel the same. So there's that buzz of energy, because we're going through or have been through the same thing. And that, the more that's happening, the more that buzz is going to be a part of the change through people and through humanity. And I mean, I am optimistic, because that's what I feel, you know?
I agree. And it's nice to see that we're having this, for lack of a better word, copulation of energy right now, where we're having this conversation and it's just rising and it's filling. And then it extends out to other people listening to it, and then it further inspires, and it just keeps on going. It's like the old commercial on TV, because I told two friends, and she told two friends, and he told two friends, mm-hmm. And it just happens exponentially, and it's something that I'm incredibly grateful for, is that nothing stays stagnant anymore. I guess it's up to the individual whether they want it to stay stagnant, because there are those people that are still maybe a little too shy, or live in that place of not quite allowing themselves, or maybe a place of fear where they're not ready to speak or share yet. But they might take it from a different angle altogether and create on some other level that they don't have to share it in that way. Whatever's happening right now, as much as the world can be a bit of a, let's say, a scary place or a hard place or a worrisome place, there are some real beautiful things that are happening right now, and we are advancing. It may be hard to see. Black Friday might hurt people so badly that we think that we're not evolved enough yet. But I think that that's just another distraction.
And a shock to the system. You know, we need shocks. It's like the body having disease to tell the body that something's not right. So these shocks, or these, for example, all these videos we've been seeing about Black Friday mayhem and barbarism, for many people, it will be a shock, and also financial losses and instability in our social lives. These are shocks, and it's not, again, it may seem like a cliche, but it's not what happens to us that's the important part. It's how we respond to it. And the world is having more shocks being put out there now, even environmental shocks. And so it's something that we really have to take as a catalyst. They've always been there, and we have to work with it. And it's a normal rhythm that people wake up according to their own pace, their own rhythm. We're not going to have everyone waking up overnight at the same time. It's just not going to happen, because we're all at different stages, we're at different levels of social conditioning, we're in different countries under different regimes with different information flows, and we're, of course, we are different inner states. So people are going to wake up in their own time, and we should nurture that and catalyze that, not missionize it or jump on someone's back. But we should understand that people are going to wake up in their own way, and that's why the world is a little bit out of balance at the moment.
And practicing compassion is something that I think we're trying to reinstate within ourselves. It's something that's coming through us, and some of us don't know what to do with it with that, because there's been such an apathy for so very long that now to feel empathy and compassion is like a huge shock to the system.
And some people, I mean, get a blast of empathy, and it could shock someone not ready for it. I mean, I frame it in what I say, moving from one set of C values to another set of C values, from conflict and competition and conflict and control to compassion, communication, collaboration, and consciousness. And so and again, it's all about the vocabulary, because vocabulary helps us to place something in context. So for many years, in terms of the internet, people talk about the global brain. Perhaps now, I mean, the global brain having a very maybe linear masculine energy, we can talk about now the empathic heart or the empathic earth. And because the networks around the world don't just connect us on a neuronal level, they connect us on an empathic level, and that's energy which is coming through these interconnections, and that's part of this feminine energy and consciousness that going back to our beginning of the conversation.
Definitely. It's so true. Now, if you were to sit back and give an explanation, say, or some kind of reasoning to the rise of this consciousness, is it something that the earth is just, it's time? Is it a universal thing? Is it, we've been through all of these trials and tribulations? Where would you try to put that?
That's a good question, and it's a huge question. It reminds me of a scene from Monty Python, the meaning of life, and Michael Palin is playing a priest, and he's standing in front of the church, in front of his congregation, and he goes, "Oh God, oh God, oh God, you are so huge."
It's so true, though. It is a big question, but if we can just compartmentalize it in, how much we don't like to do that, but just a touch, it's almost like a where were we, where are we, and where are we going?
Now, my understanding, because I can only speak for myself, and this question I can't rationalize, and I wouldn't want to. So my inner feeling is that this change of consciousness is part of a grander evolutionary process, and that it's not just, well, it's a kind of mutual relationship. It's occurring within humanity, because it's occurring outside of us on a larger scale. I think it's happening over the earth. I think there's a different energy coming on, perhaps even in a sense of a cosmic energy or cosmic scale. It's difficult to talk about that because it's only speculation. None of us can validate it scientifically. But what I feel is that this, what's happening to the Earth, what's happening to humanity, which is a membrane upon the Earth, is that we're moving through an evolutionary process, and consciousness is part of the evolutionary process. There's no evolution without the evolution of consciousness, whichever direction that goes in. And so we are part of that. And why I feel that this is a crucial time for humanity is that perhaps not in our recorded history have we been able to have a conscious awareness of participating in that process. So conscious evolution now is happening, and it's on many, many levels, like the Russian doll. You take off one doll, you got a smaller one inside, you have a smaller one inside. You know, we're having I think we're seeing changes physiologically in our bodily structure, in our gut feeling, in our instinct, in our heart, in our brain, in our social systems. It's all happening on such a large scale, and so I see it part of a grander process of evolution, Carolee. That's my answer.
I appreciate that, because it definitely is. And you know what I think is beautiful about this is that the human spirit is they've tried to control it. And in this process of evolution, we are proving that we cannot be controlled. And if we are, it's not going to be for that long before not only are we rising up for ourselves, but we are adapting in a way that is making it impossible for them to control the next adaptation. It's making their job a little bit harder, I think, that those that wish to control, it's kind of almost as if it's out of their hands now. They've created little monsters and they don't even realize it. And I mean monster in a positive light, not in some kind of negative light, but I don't think when they tried to trap the mind and control the soul and you know, keep it for themselves or whatever it is that they're doing, I think they lost the idea that we've always had this free will that was going to evolve into something that you see now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's true that they've, you know, the ruling power structures have used a certain vibration to use that word, a vibration of fear, a vibration of controlling the way we think, and therefore the mind wave, and that's been going on for I suppose for most of the cycles of civilization. But you know, someone's turned up the tap, or someone's opened the tap, or someone's turned up the volume, and so there's a different wavelength coming in now, and so you just can't hold it back, and people are tuning into it. We could say that someone's changed the radio station, and more people are changing over to the new radio station, and the old listeners they're dwindling.
Yeah, we're definitely set to a completely different frequency now, and the floodgates have been open.
Yeah, and the more people who are on the same radio station, they can talk about this and have an understanding. And although the other station are dwindling, they're still in the majority, but the energy doesn't require majority. So, and we're going to see more and more people tuning in. Yeah.
Yeah, and we do, and it happens daily. Daily, you get this reaffirmation that it is happening. You can see it in the little synchronicities or whatever you might call it. You see it on a daily basis.
Yeah.
Now, I wonder, what is it that you're working on now? I know you did say that you were working on another book of poetry, which, I mean, that was my first love as well. My very first love was sitting at my grandfather's typewriter. And typing poetry, and I still have copies of it, and you've tweaked my interests. I just might look into self-publishing some of that older material from when I was 11 and very pure in mind and heart. Because I mean, I've read over it. My daughter reads over it, and she's amazed by, she doesn't understand poetry quite. She writes in a different style than I do, and she's learning from it. So that's what I might. You just spark something in me. But writing is something that I have always loved. What are you working on right now?
I say I just self-published in November, the book called Meeting Monroe, Conversations with a Man Who Came to Earth. And it's, I guess, difficult to talk about that, but anyone who wants to look it up and read the blurb, or I've got a video on YouTube trying to explain it, probably my video self does a better job than I would do now. I'm just publishing in the next, probably next few days, a collection of poetry that I wrote 10 years ago called Songs of a Man Who Died of Love. And I want to put each one of those into an audio with music thing. I've just finished a book which is following on from my line of what I call serious books. And it follows on from the book I wrote, Dawn of the Akashic Age, with Irvin Laszlo. And the book's called The Phoenix Generation. And it's about exactly what we've been talking about the young generation coming in and how they're going to be coming in, tuning into a different radio station, and the changes that they will bring in with them, and how we now are the bridge generation, and how we've got to ground ourselves and hold on and try to, hold the fort for the younger generation coming in. So I've just finished that and just been doing the final edit, and that's coming out next autumn. And so now I've turned to, again, one of my first loves is fiction writing, and I wanted to turn to a children's book. So I'm writing a children's book now about gnomes and goblins, and which deals with different realms based on different frequencies, and how some of these gnomes and goblins are on a different frequency, but they share the earth with us, and how they interact. So that's, I'm working on that now, and I've just finished a book of poetry for this year, for 2013, called New Seeds for Earth, which I'll be putting out sometime next year, self-publishing. Yeah,
that's brilliant. Keep on creating. Never, ever, ever, ever stop.
I don't want to stop, and I hope the muse will stay with me. But really, the muse is really the connection we have inside of us, because when the Greeks talked about connecting with the muse, it was really just channeling our own self. So all we have, I think, maybe if you ask me what I want to do in the future is strengthen the connection to channel myself, so I can have a stronger conversation with myself.
And that is brilliant, because it's not outside of us, and it completely is from within. And some people mock that as being somewhat self-centered, but it's not, because we've always been that source of inspiration. Has always been within us. We are that speck of the divine here to experience our version of this life, and our inspiration comes from ourselves. How things on the outside affect us on the inside is so much part of that inspiration as well. And I mean, from my, just a note to the audience, take that and run with it.
Yeah, and don't be afraid to be selfish, because when we're selfish with the correct intention, that is to develop ourselves and our conversation with our higher self, that benefits other people. Because when the self is more manifest, it radiates out and helps other people. So really, part of trying to be a part of the world is, first, let's be a little selfish in a good way, so we can work on ourselves to benefit other people.
Definitely. I just absolutely love where this conversation has taken us, and I am very grateful that you agreed to come on this show. It's been an absolute pleasure having you. If you wanted to leave the listeners with a few last thoughts, what would they be?
The thought would be, trust yourself, love yourself, and no one is alone. And we're all together. And I just really appreciate you, everybody listening, and that you've asked me to come on. So when you first invited me, my first thought was, why do you want to talk to me? because I feel that I'm not saying anything different from what other people have got to say. And so if what I say resonates with other people, then I'm really grateful for that. So I leave people with a message that you have got every resource you need inside yourself.
And that's so true. I would really love it if you would come back and talk with us again, whether it be to promote a book or just have a conversation that's going to enlighten people and maybe make them feel just a little bit less alone. I really believe that this show is one that will definitely do that for anybody who's listening. Come and be on the show again. And until then, stay as creative as you are, because you are brilliant and such an inspiration. I thank you. To anybody listening, I do hope that you share this interview with as many people as you can, because it's something that I'm left with a very good feeling within right now. And I thank everybody for listening. Kingsley, it's been an absolute pleasure.
Well, thank you, Carolee, and I thoroughly enjoy being around your kitchen table, and thanks for sharing your honey cakes as well.
You're so welcome. So everybody, once again, you've been listening to Lifting the Veil. Until next time, peace and love and inner contentment. Take care.